Hello, everyone. Welcome to the morning show. We're coming through this morning on Channel 9 on WJOP LP Newburyport at FM 96.3. We're also coming to you on Newburyport Community Media's YouTube channel at ncmhub.org. I'm your host, Mary Jacobsen, and I am so happy to welcome my two guests this morning. Ryan Turner is here. He's music director of the Newburyport Choral Society. And Penny Lazarus is also here. She's alto section leader of the chorus. And they're here to talk about their upcoming concert on Saturday, May 14th at 7:30 p.m. and Sunday, May 15th at 4 p.m. at Belleville Congregational Church on High Street right here in Newburyport. Ryan, welcome. Thanks for taking time to visit the show.
Good to be here, Mary. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you, too. And Penny, thank you also. Welcome. I appreciate your taking time to visit the show to talk about the concert this morning. So, well, let's start with the concert's theme and then talk about the music. Tell us about the theme, Songs for the Journey, From Remembrance to Renewal. Please tell us the significance of the theme, especially at this point in time.
Yeah, as you mentioned, the name of the concert is Songs for the Journey. It's been interesting in that I've been now in my second year as music director of the Newburyport Choral Society, and of course have only conducted one concert and have only seen probably the faces of about 20% of the choir.
these are the COVID times.
These are the times, exactly. But you know, we've kept singing.
Yes.
And we've kept making music, and we've kept our sense of community and connecting with one another, which is what's the most important. But it, you know, as we near hopefully something that's an ending of this pandemic or endemic or whatever phase we're in, I wanted a concert that would celebrate our sense of community, but at the same time also, you know, have a sense of mourning so much that has been lost, and then looking towards the future. So, and the Fourier Requiem has always been a piece to me that speaks to me in a way that's not just about mourning the loss of a loved one, but it also has a sense of hopeful renewal and peace to it. So it's not, I mean, Fourier even intentionally leaves out all the texts about eternal hell and damnation and the Dies Irae, and you're going to be swallowed up by the lion's mouth, and all these, you know, incredibly vivid texts that we're used to hearing in like a Verdi or a Mozart Requiem. But this one is about eternal light, eternal peace, eternal joy. And so it's been now over 12 years. The last time I conducted this piece, and when I did it, I commissioned one of our own New England's own composers, Kevin Siegfried, who's a faculty member at Boston Conservatory. I commissioned him to write a piece that was specifically created as a companion piece to the Fourier Requiem. The Fourier Requiem in Fourier's preferred instrumentation doesn't use any high strings, meaning no violins, which is a unique thing in orchestrations not to have violins. He has one solo violin for one movement, and that's all. So I commissioned Kevin to write a companion piece that would use the same chamber orchestration that did not include violins. That was in 2010. Since then, he's modified the piece quite a bit, and I revisited it, and he added a soprano solo, and it seemed like the perfect way to fill out the program. And then we've also sort of added in a few a cappella pieces as well. And the whole concept is talking about this idea of struggle, loss, renewal, and hope.
Well, and one can never have, I think, too much eternal light and eternal joy. Let it be said.
Exactly.
And so praise be for that. And
I mean, it's really important to acknowledge that even if one has had the good fortune not to lose a close family member or friend during the pandemic, but everybody feels a loss of 2 years of their life. That we've all had to have given up things, and we all find ourselves trying to recapture that. So,
yeah, good point, Penny. You're absolutely right about that. I find myself often feeling, as we are able to start returning more to normal, like having a concert, an in-person concert, I feel like I've almost forgotten what life was like and what I used to do prior to the pandemic, because it went on for a long time, but it is joyful to rediscover. And so those are the twin themes here, the remembrance, and there is mourning, but also the recovery and the restoration. And there are healing passages in the foray, and certainly many healing, lovely passages in the Kevin Siegfried Songs for the Journey. And here is when, how do I know that I have to be transparent and say I'm a member of the chorus? So I therefore I also know that Kevin Siegfried made a visit to a rehearsal of the chorus last week. And I would like to find out what that was like for you, Ryan, having the composer there to be with you while the chorus rehearsed.
Well, I tell you, anytime I get to work with a composer, I find it inspiring, instructional, invigorating. It's one of the great joys as a conductor to get to work with living composers and the dialogue that happens there. I happen to know Kevin quite well. We're colleagues, we're friends, our families know each other, and I've worked with Kevin on a number of occasions now, and so I haven't seen him though in probably 3 or 4 years, and this was so it was a nice sort of reconnecting with Kevin. But one of the things that's always fantastic about having a composer present is, one, I feel like the choir is on heightened alert, on their best behavior, as it were, because of course they, you know, they feel, as we all do, this sense of responsibility to the text and to the composer's work and to making this art come to life. And for me, the dialogue that happens, you know, one of the things, having worked with Kevin enough to know that he's not one of these composers that overmarks his music. Some composers get incredibly specific and to a degree of leaving out the artistic interpretation of the performer. And I feel like Kevin gives the conductor and the choir room for their own identity to come through and their own ideas. And so, you know, there are a number of times where I'd say, you know, what were you thinking here, Kevin? What if we tried this? And finding how that worked out and coming to some, hopefully some new ideas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Penny, how did you find it singing in the chorus and having the composer there? Were you on
It was wonderful. I've had the opportunity to be in other choral rehearsals where composers have been present, but I don't think I ever witnessed the exchange that Kevin had with Ryan in this context. It was amazing. Of course, Ryan is that type of director. He's always so open to what may come along in the moment or what somebody else might talk to him about. But I mean, they were talking about things like time signatures, and it may sound dry, but it wasn't at all. Like, the final movement is written in a 3/4 time. It's a beautiful Celtic blessing that Kevin worked with. And Ryan said, you know, I don't feel this as a waltz in three. I feel this is over 4 measures, like it's in 12/4 time. And Kevin said, that's exactly right. It should not be a waltz. And it was like, whoa. I mean, that kind of thing changed the whole flow of the movement for all of us. And to watch these two professionals have this dialogue, you know, with us and in front of us was just beautiful. It was really full of information.
Oh, very well put, Penny, much better than I could have. And I would also add that the Celtic blessing is one of my favorites. My mother was very, very Irish, and I grew up with that blessing always on the wall of our house. And I'm sure there are many, many people of Irish descent who know you Ryan, who know that blessing, and it's important, and it's such a beautiful. It brings tears to my eyes every time we sing it. And so, people, you're not going to want to miss any of the concert, but especially Songs for the Journey and the Celtic Blessing. Well, there's many other wonderful pieces, and we're also singing Sarah Cortell's How Can I Keep From Singing? So tell us a little bit about that and how you see that fitting in with the theme of the concert.
Almost 2 years ago now, when we came together on Zoom for the first time, One of the pieces I introduced to the choir was this arrangement of the Robert Lowry hymn, How Can I Keep From Singing? As arranged by female Canadian composer, contemporary composer Sarah Courtell. And one of the things I've always had in my head is that the Newburyport Choral Society should have a repertoire of three, four, five pieces that anybody that has ever sung in the Newburyport Choral Society or will sing knows these pieces, a sense of this community connection that we all have in common, so that if you got together, 15, 20, 30 people over different periods of time from the Newburyport Choral Society, they could sing together because it was something they knew. And so I'm trying to introduce these pieces, and this is one of them. Also is another piece on the program called The Road Home by Stephen Paulus. And also to me, it just sort of was an emblem for what these 2 years have been about, and how indeed can we keep from singing together. And there's also, and Penny, I'd love for you to talk a little bit about this because you do so poignantly, this undercurrent of it's not just about the words at the surface, that as there is in most songs, even we're doing the Lift Every Voice and Sing arrangement by Zenaida Robles, and there's in every bit of hope and joy, there's struggle. And I think it's important for us to always remember that. And the undercurrent of the struggle in all these works is at the core of it.
Right, and but it's never the end note, because even the
Exactly.
last piece of the Kevin Siegfried is he reminded us, please don't sing this, as a gloomy, sad goodbye song. It's really, and that he even scored parts of the chorus that were a cappella or singing by ourselves that he called a gathering point of even joy and looking ahead. And the same with How Can I Keep From Singing? It's so many folk singers have used it over the years, including Pete Seeger. And when Ryan introduced us to this piece, and we got to talk to the composer on Zoom about this piece, it was the height of COVID. We knew we couldn't be together. This was pre-vaccination months. And we didn't know when we'd be able to get back to together to sing. And we didn't even know that having rehearsals with Ryan, who was our new director, would work on Zoom. And this was such a good piece to launch into and remember that there will be a rainbow at the end of all of this. We will be able to go on and keep singing. So,
Yeah. Well,
yeah.
thanks. Yeah, thanks. Very well put, Penny. And yeah, both of those pieces have that quality to them. There's another piece that is going to be in this concert, and that's Across the Vast Eternal Sky by Oleg Yelho. And could you say a few things about that piece and how it fits in?
Sure. Ola Yelo is a contemporary Norwegian composer who works a lot with the American poet Charles Anthony Silvestri. Charles Anthony Silvestri is an interesting and unique poet in that he doesn't write poetry for poetry's sake. Almost all of his poetry is done with choral commissions. So essentially, he's writing with a song in his heart or with music on the mind. We take it for granted there's lyricism and a singing quality to poetry. And he takes it to the next level in that he knows everything he writes will be sung because it's based on choral commissions. This particular poem, Across the Vast Eternal Sky, takes as its launching off point the image of a phoenix, or the bird that dies in ashes and then has a new life and rebirth. And that's another sort of overarching image of this concert as well. This is a and the idea of rebirth and new life is shown in this piece by this sort of ratcheting up of keys. It gets higher and higher and higher, and there's this sense of something being reborn, taking, flying off, giving new wings and new life to it. And it's a wonderful arrangement that has solo piano with string quartet and chorus.
Yeah, it's a piece of music that I find merits the term transcendent. And I think people will really, really, really feel like they have transcended many aspects of the pandemic, or I hope that's how people feel. So anyway, Penny, did you have anything you wanted to add about?
Well, like even it, though it's a contemporary piece, and sometimes people are a little leery about listening to something contemporary, this, because of its recurrent theme of rebirth and this raising of the keys higher and higher and higher, you're going to hear the theme again and again and again. And by the time it ends, you will feel like you really know it. And you have a sense of what the piece is suggesting. You'll feel it in your body. So I think as keys rise, we kind of tend to sit a little higher, even if we're not aware of it. So you're kind of going to always be rising in your seat. It's a beautiful, beautiful piece. And it was suggested to the Ryan in the music committee by another singer in the chorus. And it's become very special.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, and then the concert is going to end with one of the great joyful noises of all time, Lift Every Voice. So could you say, you mentioned that before, Ryan, could you say a little bit more about this particular piece?
Yes, so Lift Every Voice and Sing, which there's much to say about it, but just very briefly, is essentially over time since the early 1900s become the Black National Anthem. And it's a symbol of struggle and overcoming strife and marching forward, and that there still is strife and we continue this struggle. Contemporary composer, again, a Black woman from California, her name is Zenaida Robles, wrote this piece a few years ago as an arrangement of the well-known tune, adding her own voice into it and her own harmonization. And it, as any time a piece is arranged, a well-known piece, you sort of retain that, the original tune in your head, but then are influenced by the composer's ideas and how they want to take you on a journey, as it were. And this is scored for soprano solo, the choir, and then a rather elaborate and boisterous or joyful piano part that our accompanist Kirsten Hegeland will be playing. And the other thing I will say is that about the whole program, there's this overarching theme that in one of the pieces we're doing by Stephen Paulus that's called The Road Home, there's a line in there that says, with love in my heart as the only song. Yeah. And for me, that was one of the guiding themes. And that through each piece, there's this recurring theme and talk about love. And this is not the romantic love. This is the love for neighbor, love for community, love for humanity that I'm hoping is the thread that takes us to the end of this program. And it's this love is the thread and the overlying theme of this journey together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely, and a noble theme it is, and it's a very exciting concert, and I can't wait to sing it.
Good.
Well, yeah, Penny, go ahead.
Oh, I had just found out that. While this piece was written by two brothers in the Deep South after Reconstruction, so this is some of the worst periods of racial strife for Black people. This was the era of the Ku Klux Klan and lynchings, and they wrote it for a commemoration for their school of Abraham Lincoln's birthday. Oh. And then they left and they moved to New York City, as many Black people did during that period of time, having no idea how this poem that they wrote and this music started to travel throughout schools in the South, became so well known that the NAACP is the ones who wanted to then make it an African-American national anthem. But the story doesn't stop there. So we now call it the Black National Anthem, but there are many, many people of color today who never mean for this song to imply a separation from the national anthem of America. And so there's actually, as there's a movement for before Congress to nominate this piece as the national hymn of America for everybody. But unfortunately, it's been it was tabled in February 2022 by a conservative Republican senator. So we're still waiting for that story to come to fruition.
Well, thank you for that historical footnote, Penny. That's really fascinating. And legislation always takes time, but I think it would make a brilliant national hymn. And so we'll just keep our fingers crossed and hope for the best and sing the heck out of it. It will bring people to their feet and it will blast the top, the roof off Belleville.
It will. It really
it
will.
It will, won't it? Yeah. Well, let's talk a little bit about a sneak peek, perhaps, because I know everyone in the chorus is very excited about some plans that are brewing for the winter concert. And could you give us a sneak preview of what's in store for next December? Worth waiting for, everybody.
Gladly. So this ties into the composer that did the arrangement of Lift Every Voice and Sing. Her name again is Zenaida Robles. As many probably know about our beloved, acclaimed poet from the Dominican Republic here in Newburyport, Rina Espaillat, who is a friend of the Newburyport Choral Society, and I know has had her works set to music and spoken, orated with the Newburyport Chamber Festival and all over Newburyport and all over the world, quite frankly. A few of the members of the chorus came to me and said, why don't we set some of her music to for the chorus and commission a composer and premiere these works? Which I thought was a fantastic idea, not knowing Rina, knowing the name, but I had the wonderful opportunity to meet with her and she read some of her poetry to me. And we talked for hours about her poetry and what it might look like to have it set to music. And flash forward about almost a year, 6 months or so, I was able to commission Zenaida Robles from the West Coast to set three of Rina Espaillat's poems, and they will be a sort of a triptych or a suite of three different poems, three different works that'll be set for the Newburyport Choral Society with Chamber Orchestra, and also the middle movement, which is a piece that will be done both in Spanish and English, will include the Greater Newburyport Children's Chorus.
Oh, wonderful.
One of the things I will say that and ties into the program we're doing now is this theme of love for one another. And one of Rina's poems, which was the sort of the launching pad for this whole commission, is a piece called Guidelines. And I'm gonna butcher the poetry here now, and Penny will help me because I don't have it right in front of me. But one of the lines is, here's what you need to do. Love something with all your heart.
Yeah.
And what a great guideline for life. And we're incredibly excited to see what Zenaida comes up with. And I'll be working with her over the summer. And it'll be really exciting to involve the Greater Newburyport Children's Chorus and be able to premiere this work at our holiday concert in December of 2022.
Yeah, absolutely. Rina is the poet laureate of Newburyport, I think, and something of a light being. So that sounds very, very exciting. And we have to wait until December, but it sounds like it'll be fantastic when it gets here. But in the meantime, we have the concert coming
up
very soon. And if you want information or tickets, everybody can go to newburyportchoralsociety.org and get all the information that you need there. So Ryan and Penny, any final thoughts or information you'd like people to have about the concert before we finish today?
It's going to be beautiful. It's people are vaxxed and there'll be masks still. So if that's a concern, please don't worry. Seating would be spread out. It's really worth your hour and 15 minutes to come in out of the sun and feel the seasons moving forward in rebirth, as well as the music here. It's really going to be very rewarding.
And you're a total optimist to say come in from the sun. But but we can hope.
We can hope.
Benny, thank you so much. Ryan, thank you so much. It's always a joy to talk to you both, and it's going to be an extraordinary concert. Can't wait. Thank you so much. Bye for now.
Take care. Thank you, Barry. Take care. Thank you, Penny.
Thank you.
Thank you.